Well, today my conversation is with Dr. Dunn. Is it Philos or Philos?
Philos.
Philos, Dr. Dunn Philos, author of Tales of a Pet Vet, Stories from the Clinic and House Calls. This was a great book. It was kind of a timely book too. You know why? A couple days ago, I was in a pet store and I saw this cat's eyes that just looked vacant, zombie-like, like another cat I had adopted years ago. Couldn't get her out of my head, so I ended up adopting her. Her name is Gigi.
Oh my!
Yeah, and you know, Gigi must have gone through something because you know, reading your book, I mean, it's so heartfelt, the stories that you shared and the things that you learn from an animal. What drew you to want to be a vet?
Well, you probably saw in my book, I was just raised with animal lovers, almost animal fanatics. And we had a monkey, we had all these pets. And I guess I liked the challenge of this was my passion. But you know, for a brief time, I considered even being a pediatrician, a human doctor. And I guess I'm drawn to patients that can't speak for themselves. I love babies when they're newborn and little and watch them sort of their body language, you know, and watch them
figure
evolve.
Them out, like figure them out.
Exactly. I like puzzles. I guess that's just, I like to solve problems. And so that combined with my childhood, I really just, it was the perfect career for me. But I also, you know, like talking, obviously I love sitting and meeting people. They're these stories, even though they're, I quickly go from memoir and my story to it's the people I've met and how they've changed me. And they're the people and the families of the pets and the pets. And they're far more interesting, you know, than I'll ever be. So it's a lot about them and what I've learned from them and unexpectedly how they changed my life in such a better way. And meeting people like you that are adopting senior pets with medical baggage, you know, and emotional baggage, you know, that vacant look in her, Gigi, she's got a story to tell, you know, and sometimes you sort of figure it out. She's afraid of men or men with beards or people with brooms, you know, and you look at them and you're like, oh, you know, it might take years.
Walter, I had a cat, Walter, who, the one that has the same look that Gigi had. And when I would go down to pet him, he would cower on all fours to the back, obviously thinking a hand was going to hit him or something. He hid for a year. I let him hide for a year. And then after a year, I started closing down doors to force him to be with the rest of the five cats and me. And out he came, and he ended up being the most social of the cats. Like, he bloomed. And I have a feeling that's what you love doing.
Oh my goodness. And isn't it the best challenge when especially a cat like that, that they turn around. And there's a blog I had written about. So I have this blog, Dr. Dawn the Pet Vet. And one of them is a James Herriot story about this cat that was so feral, and he had lost his mate, and he just was persistent for months and months and months. Like you have to be patient.
Yeah.
Yeah. A pet parent. And then there's this switch, you know, and I've seen it 1,000 times where they trust you all of a sudden, the pet family. And in this James Herriot story, he's like, you know, his wife was like, why are you, you know, do you every day go out there? And finally the cat let him pet her. And he says, you don't understand. This is like the biggest source of joy he knew to be patient. And the reward is a nervous cat's or a traumatized cat's love and affection. And then there, and he bloomed. And that is the greatest story. Those are the stories I like to tell, especially to those who aren't cat people.
Yeah. I don't know. I just don't know how you can do what you do and see what you see. And hear about what you hear about. Like, I can't even go into a shelter to adopt a pet. Like, I would call Dr. Jen from Crash's Landing in Grand Rapids, and I'd say, I want to adopt a cat. Give me the cat that's either been there the longest or who nobody wants or has been returned as like he's on his third strike or something. And I have found people go, oh, the cat's thankful to you. I don't know if that's it, but I mean, it is fun to be able to see that you take these animals who, you know, went through a lot of stuff, obviously, because they don't act normal. You know, there's just like PTSD or something, and just give them the time to unfold, you know, just unfold.
Yeah. And so your Dr. Jen, or I have assistants, and one of my nurse assistants runs a cat rescue, and I have relationships with all sorts of pet rescues, and I'm establishing more of them as I sort of move. And so, for example, you know, your cat that you adopted, he wouldn't do well in a house with five children that are pulling his tail. So you hope that you have a rescue or an advocate to help place the right pet in the right with the right,
right
home, because you're more likely to have a good outcome, and you're a dream pet parent, cat parent. But you know, it might be a cat that can only be in a single cat household, and so you place for different reasons, and you do as much homework before, and then it's just the greatest thing when it works out.
Yeah.
I mean,
there was a wonderful behaviorist. I don't know if she's still practicing. Her name is Kate Gamble. And she was a behaviorist out in California, I think of the San Francisco region, but she helped me with some of my kids. How did your book come to be? I kind of have an idea on how it might have come to be, but how did it come to be?
Well, you know, so what had happened is, you know, and I talk about this in my, when I give book talks, is I had been in brick and mortar practices. And at one point, soon before I wrote the book, I started a blog because it was to supplement a pet first aid course that I was teaching. And I'm doing all this research, and I'm like, why don't I put it on a website and clients, you know, because I like to talk to clients and I like to be able to spend time and make sure they understand it, particularly when they're stressed and they forget, like when, you know, when you're home, read this article. And so I had this blog, which was a lot of information and pet news, and then just sort of, it was an extension of journaling. I started writing these personal stories about like how poorly trained my dogs were, or just funny anecdotes, or what really I'm passionate about are the benefits of the human animal bond and for depression and children with autism. And those got the most response. I would get so much feedback from those blogs that it occurred to me, maybe that combined with all these stories that I've been telling friends and family for years, that's what people want to hear more of. And people want to be the best pet parents they can be. They're always reading all these books. And so this is a little different in that it's, so I put it in the format of the book, but it's, you've read it, it's one part like James Harriet, modern day James Harriet. It's a one part behind the scenes, like Anthony Bourdain, like this is what it's like in our hearts and our minds, and the humor and the craziness of it. And a lot of the humor and heart, like the human mistakes of Marley and me. And so it sort of came together in that, that way. And there is information, veterinary information to drive the stories. Mainly it's, I guess if you would agree, and a few chapters are a little heavier on the information, but I thought it was very important to have a lot of time to explain, for example, the euthanasias and the process and the fact that there's in-home euthanasia is even an option. Because the saddest thing for me is when I would meet someone who never knew that it was a possibility, and I wish I could have done that. So that was a little bit different than some of the very funny chapters.
Yeah.
In my mind.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's a fun book. It's an easy book to read, and it's a fun book to read. You know, you've got, let me put that down before it slides off. You've kind of got like a roller coaster of emotion. I like the, when you were describing the seven types of pet parents, I immediately thought, well, you definitely are the helicopter pet parent.
Well, I mean, you're the helicopter.
I am, yes.
Okay, yeah, because I was, I'm not so much,
yeah.
But it's so funny, and I poke fun, but it explains so much. And I'm sort of a no frills. My pets would never, one of my dogs would let us dress him up, my kids. I'm amazed at what people will let their will their pets will let them
I'm
do.
Not, no, I don't do crazy stuff like that, just so you know. Nobody gets dressed up in outfits.
Well, I shouldn't say that. We had a costume party growing up for dogs and when I grew up. As a matter of fact, I shared this on social media yesterday. I was a judge for a dog park Halloween costume, and I said I have achieved all that I want, and I'm like, I'm overqualified. That was really fun. And just, I mean, it's amazing.
You share some really funny stories in the book. Do you have like favorites that come to mind that you maybe have shared at, you know, cocktail parties or parties you've been at?
My favorite, well, yes, I've shared so many of them, and my favorite story, and I will preface this with the lead-in to sort of these eccentric events is my family. Like, I'm an emotional wreck at times. I do irrational things. My family were just bonkers at some of the, I'm sure people thought, I mean, I brought a monkey to school. Like, who does that? And so that said, I feel that I hope people know I'm sharing it. You know, I have liberty. I poke a lot of fun at myself.
Yes, yes.
And I get it. And the family with the cat quinceañera, that was just to me my favorite story in the book.
Share it.
And so I was, of course, working alone in a brick and mortar at the time. And I get this call and I hear yelling and help, and there's blood and there's screaming. And I didn't know what was going on. I knew it was a client. I said, just come in. And by the time they came in, it was like seven cats and five people. And they decided to have a birthday party for a 15-year-old cat, which is such a bad idea on many levels, which I discuss. And like, it's a 15-year-old cat. You don't have a party for a cat. You know, he's like 110 years old as a, you know, equivalent.
Yeah.
Bringing strange cats into a home where that's also a bad idea. And then you give them catnip because this very elaborate. And by the time they came in, that it kind of had the effect of, by the time they came in, they went from screaming and fighting to asleep. And I'm like, are these the same cats?
Yeah, right.
We were talking about? So we found a minor wounds. You know, it was like I call it a melee at the lasagna tray. They use the catnip as cheese. And it's like, why would you do that? And I didn't judge them. I treated them. And I'm like, okay, you know, I'm in the back of my mind, I'm like, I could see my mother doing this, you know.
Yeah, it's like intention, right? It was, you know, it was all about intention, I think. That's what I mean. The stories are so fun. Like, you're going to laugh out loud when you're reading them. You see more than just cats and dogs too. That was, I mean, what has some of the crazier, weirder animals you've seen?
I think my favorite overall chapter is what I call the exotics chapter, which is exotic species, which are not dogs and cats mainly. And so I saw so many iguanas and snakes and pigs and birds. I was really bad at turtle medicine.
Yeah. So,
you know, I'm certainly, but I had some beginner's luck. And I got, in spite of myself, I had this husband put through med school. Oh. And they're like, here's your job. You're seeing pigs and iguanas and a snake with pneumonia. And that was probably
an interesting one. The snake with pneumonia. Who would have thought, right?
Who would have thought? And the way it played out was perfect. And so people ask me, like, what's the most interesting? I think that. And then once animal control brought in a red-tailed hawk, and we needed to figure out how to X-ray it without getting mauled,
right,
and not getting hurt or hurting him. And how do I X-ray a bird? And so we figured it out, as I always did. I figured it out. I'm still here. But it's just a very eventful, challenging career with a lot of variety, and I wouldn't have had it any other way. I think human medicine, you know, I look at my husband as a human doctor, and just doing the same sort of oncology or whatever subspecialty, I would be bored. It would.
And plus the talking patient.
Exactly.
Highly overrated. What would you say is the most difficult part of your job?
I think the most difficult part of my job It would be setting boundaries, particularly with the house call. People just thinking that, they can, they expect me to get up in the middle of the night and run to them. And if I don't, I'm a terrible person just in
Right.
front of me or something. Like, social media is a double-edged
That's
sword.
it. That's exactly right.
And we get a lot of bad press, and we always joke, they're like, they're just in it for the money. Or I'm like, really? Well, what
Yeah,
money? Because
right.
is there some boat? I mean, of course there's money, but if I was in a business just for money, I don't know that I would. I've
And if you were
spent.
in the business just for money, you'd be getting up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I wouldn't have
Right?
spent 10 years in school
Right,
that
exactly.
money.
What in your job brings you the most joy?
I would say, like, a situation like what you just told me of seeing a pet get adopted, and that was potentially going to be euthanized or just traumatized by not having, for reasons out of their control.
Right.
And just the best part also to me has been this. I've just been humbled by people like you, the humanity, what people are willing to do. You see a lot of the worst, but a lot of the best of our own species in the way that they treat their pets. And that's been really helpful. And I found that I made a difference in their lives, seeing them, particularly in their homes. I wanted to hear about their family because these are pets are members of their family. So you do make a difference, particularly for people that live alone. And this is the only
Companionship.
the companionship. And so it was vital for me to keep their pet healthy because it was vital to them. And so that really made the biggest impact in my career, I think, later.
I was reading something in your book, and the thing is I'd seen it on my Facebook feed, right? I'm going, I've see, saw more and more people talking about it, but I scrolled by because I didn't know what it was, and it, I didn't, my cat didn't have it. And you talk about it in the book, Addison's, right? What is that? And why am I just hearing about that all of a sudden?
So Addison's disease, usually we'll see it in dogs. John F. Kennedy had it, and it's a very
Oh.
commonly underdiagnosed disease because you can have symptoms that are subtle or mimic, like you puppies with diarrhea. I mean, how many puppies? They're constantly eating things, but there are certain hints that you might see, you hope to see earlier, and to try to do diagnostics to pick it up, as opposed to the far more common scenario, which is they come in a life-threatening, critical condition, and you are treating them. So that's always best avoided. I like to avoid any of those emergencies. And I feel like with experience, I was able to pick up on that earlier. And I think we're getting better at that. But it's hard to convince someone who has a seemingly normal, healthy pet puppy who's maybe just gotten into something to do these diagnostics. And in human medicine, it would be automatic. You go to the
Right.
doctor and they do it, but you have to sort of get very good at communicating without scaring them, like I did early in my career when all these clients were fainting because my delivery got better. And you get better at sort of reading the client. Do they want details? Do they want bottom line? And you have multiple times a day trying to establish an effective way of communicating and not judging and just saying, like I always say, I hope I'm wrong, but it'd be really great if we could have this information now before it's an emergency. So that was one of the reasons, I think, in the emergency chapter, things I want clients to know to prevent things spiraling into an out of control emergency or a more expensive emergency ultimately.
I know you're on a book tour. I've only got you for a couple more minutes. I was funny reading about the marijuana, aka the people's catnip. That was a great one. And by the way, before we go, you got to tell me, what was that gross piece of equipment that was in the garage?
Oh, it's the so I had a house call practice, and I had a big freezer that the crematorium
Oh.
would come. Oh, you're the only person to ask me that. And my kids just, oh, it took them a while to get used to that. But
Yeah.
it's part of my service, and so I would bring them to my home. And then
Yeah,
I
that's
would.
almost nicer, really, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I would say to people, because they're always like, how do you know that the patients pass? I'm like, trust me, I'm 100, I am not taking a patient to my home if I'm
Right.
100%, because you go through the whole process. And so yeah, that was the piece of equipment.
I love it. You know, my favorite chapter might be the one about eccentric clients. That was that I may be one an eccentric client after reading that chapter. I don't know if this was on purpose or what, but it is kind of interesting that I had adopted this Gigi. And I called my behaviorist, tried to get a hold of my behaviorist. She couldn't do it. What do you think? I'm going to ask you for some free advice, okay? What do you, I brought her into the house. Goldie's here. Right now, she's in her own room chilling out. She's only been here for 2 days. This will be the second day. And when I put Goldie's in a safe place and let Gigi out to explore, Gigi getting anywhere near Goldie has been sends her into a fear, rage, hissing. Just the
Right,
smell of
right.
another cat. What do you think would cause that? And I mean, I'm trying to, I've got that plug-in in the wall too to
Oh, good,
try to
good.
help feel away or something.
Yeah, I have so many posts on social media and blogs about this because,
I'll have
and
to
you're a
check it out.
cat person, so you want them to adjust. They should be in separate rooms for as long as it takes.
Yeah.
And get used to the sound and get used to the smell. And then maybe they see each other for a minute a day, and then it's 2 minutes, and the smell of them on you. And what you want to do now, what I would say to
I'm
you is
switching
try
out bedwear and stuff.
switch out bedwear, but have them try to maybe feed her, reassociate the smell and the sight. Or of her on you and on in the room with something positive. So
Yeah.
you're going to do positive reinforcement. So now she'll start to, or whatever it is, if it's petting her or whatever that brings her joy, often it's feeding, but not always, or playing a
This
game.
cat is food motivated.
Well, then feed her when, have her associate, like if she's not maybe while she's screaming, but maybe a piece of item of clothing with the smell of your new cat and give it to her. But
When
you
I
don't want
did that,
another.
she hissed and hissed and hissed at that blanket. It
Yeah.
was, it was, but here's what I was thinking of doing. What do you think about this? I've got a glass door. I
Yeah.
was thinking about once they've been hungry all night and they're real wake up hungry, I was going to put one bowl on one side of the glass door and the other bowl on the other side of the glass door. So if they wanted to eat, they had to at least look at each other. What do you think about that?
I would be wary of doing that immediately. I would do it gradually, or maybe for a minute at a time with the glass door
Okay.
that cover, and then unveil it. You don't want to have a food aversion,
Aversion, right.
because and there are several blogs on my blog is Dr. Dawn the Pet Vet. There are several posts about not having a stressful environment, the food bowl away. Some cats want their own area to eat, and not
Yeah.
even if they get along, they don't want it, or there may
No.
be sub there may be some stress between them, and that might be more stress inducing. They may not want to or be reluctant to eat with somebody watching, another cat watching them.
Right. Good point. That's why I had you on. Here you go. Tales of a Pet Vet, Stories from the Clinic and House Calls by Dr. Don Filos. Where is your website? Where can people reach out to you?
My website's on the internet, www. DrDonThePetVet.com. The book is available in audio, pardon, paperback that you have, and ebook anywhere books are sold.
That's a great cover, too.
I enjoyed that. Yeah,
Beautiful.
that I didn't paint it, even though I do paint. I think they did a great job.
They did. Thank you so much for your time today. Wishing you the best.
Thanks so much. I appreciate it.
Take care.
Bye.